Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Alexia Kannas, lecturer in Media and Cinema Studies at RMIT University in Melbourne, Australia. And it's a real pleasure to be with you again at KURJA POLT in 2021, even in this slightly different format where I'm coming to you from across the seas. My talk today comes out of a research project I've been working on with my collaborator Dr. Donna McRae, who is a filmmaker and academic at Deakin University. This research has principally been conducted on the lands of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nations, who are the traditional owners of this land, and so we respectfully recognise their elders past, present and future. In Richard Lowenstein's 2009 documentary We're Livin on Dog Food, the late Australian musician Rowland S. describes the Melbourne post-punk scene of the late 1970s and early 1980s as a world nobody else knew about, a world of hidden treasure. This ephemeral yet highly influential subculture is often thought about in terms of its key figures, having laid the groundwork for the careers of now-renowned artists including Nick Cave of The Birthday Party and later Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds, and Lisa Gerrard of the band Dead Can Dance. In his 2009 article about Lowenstein's film, scholar Darren Tofts points out that this scene was characteristically hostile to memorialization and longevity, to making history. My talk today is about how film has functioned as a particularly important site for the memorialization of the Melbourne post-punk scene, and I'll be exploring how the figure of the ghost and the notion of ghostliness more broadly has become key to this process of memorialization. Melbourne is geographically divided by a river called the Yarra, which flows through its centre, splitting the city into north and south precincts. Reading Melbourne through the lens of the post-punk scene of the late 70s and early 80s reveals a constellation of groups organised around this split. On the south side, a venue known as the Crystal Ballroom was at the centre of the decadent, drug-infused culture that produced bands like The Boys Next Door, The Birthday Party, The Moodists, and Young Charlatans. Meanwhile, on the north side, a more eclectic and cerebral brand of musical experimentation emerged known as the Little Band Scene, and this produced acts like The Primitive Calculators and Dead Can Dance. There is a sense in which these various groups operated as tribes who were not always aligned in terms of their values and aesthetics, but at the same time this scenario produced differentiated and quite nuanced sensibilities, making for a particularly rich cultural moment where loads of experimentation was happening across various art forms. Despite being organised around a topography that shapes the experience of everyday life in Melbourne, the post-punk scene itself, in its heyday, was not necessarily visible at the level of the mainstream, certainly not in terms of its significant value and contribution to arts culture. But at the moment, this is really changing. Melbourne's post-punk memory sites have become increasingly visible via the process of remediation, or in other words, the recontextualization of one media form via its representation in another. Astrid Earle describes this as a process that tends to solidify cultural memory, creating and stabilizing certain narratives and icons of the past. The mapping of post-punk Melbourne occurs at least partly through what Dagmar Brunau identifies as a range of placemaking activities that reflect the multidirectionality of the cultural memory of a city. And this placemaking happens at various levels. The Melbourne Music Bus Tour, for instance, takes music tourists on a journey through the geographical terrain of Melbourne's rock and roll history and stops at a number of important sites of the city's post-punk scene. The tour is led by Bruce Milne, a key figure of the historical scene, but it is also sanctioned by the Victorian government and advertised on the Arts Centre Melbourne website. And as such, it works to remediate the post-punk scene in a way that pulls it back into Melbourne's cultural history more broadly. More recently, author Kristen Krauth has used the Melbourne post-punk scene as the setting for her 2020 novel Almost a Mirror, which was also nominated for a National Penguin Literary Prize. What I'm really interested in today, of course, is the way that cinema has participated in these placemaking activities and how there has been a tendency to characterise the place of post-punk Melbourne through the use of tropes we might normally associate with cult cinema or the horror film in particular. While these films make visible some of the scene's key memory sites and showcase its creative energy, they also tend to foreground a dark aesthetic and a haunting tone. And they tend to do this in two ways, either through the narrative and themes of the films and or at the level of film form. So let's look at some examples. It's impossible to talk about the memorialization of the Melbourne post-punk scene without acknowledging the important and complex role played by director Richard Lowenstein's 1986 film Dogs in Space. This film is often characterised as being about Melbourne's little band scene in particular, but it is really a mix of moments, places and personalities from the post-punk scene more broadly. The action in this film is principally set in a large two-story weatherboard house which is located at 18 Berry Street in the inner city suburb of Richmond. This is a real house that exists at this real address, and it was built in 1886 by an Irish immigrant named Henry Frensham. Throughout the 1970s and 1980s, though, the house was occupied by a host of people connected to the Melbourne post-punk scene, and it was the site of post-punk parties and band rehearsals. By the time Dogs in Space went into production in 1985, the Berry Street house had been sold and renovated, but Lowenstein insisted on using it as the film's principal location because of its significance, and he spent a whole lot of the film's production budget to move the owners out and to restore the house to its pre-renovated condition. This was a move that Michael Mayerfield Bell might describe as treating that spirited place with ritual care to ensure that the place is an appropriate homage to the ghost or ghosts within. Let's take a look at what the house looked like when they made Dogs in Space.
The
The attention to detail evident here in the mise-en-scène results in the Berry Street house becoming a key character in this film. Its unlocked door opens into a labyrinthine series of narrow hallways and overstuffed rooms decorated with electrical tape, torn posters, and empty soup tins. The walls are peeling and cracked. This dilapidation points to the many cycles of occupation and habitation, and the Berry Street house is charged with an uncanny energy that connotes both past and present simultaneously. This spectral energy is most palpable in a scene near the end of the film, where Anna, played by Saskia Post, awakens after shooting heroin and wanders the house in a state of blissful euphoria. The otherworldliness of this sequence is foregrounded by the expressive red and blue lighting Lowenstein uses, as well as the fact that we no longer hear the characters. In this sequence, the sounds of Dogs in Space's diegetic world have disappeared, as the metronomic bass line of Iggy Pop's 1979 song The Endless Sea increasingly begins to dominate the soundtrack. Anna glides down the hallway and through the other rooms of the house in her white 60s cocktail dress. And by the time she gets into the white limousine with Sam, who's played by Michael Hutchins, at the end of the sequence, we begin to realise what has happened. Anna has overdosed and died in their bedroom. And what we've been watching is Anna's ghost haunting the Berry Street house. What I think you can see in these two clips from Dogs in Space, particularly when they're side by side, are the ways that the film chronicles both the Melbourne post-punk scene's liveness and energy, as well as its darkness and instability. Another important post-punk site is the venue that was then known as the 𝗣𝗼𝘀𝘁 or Crystal Ballroom, which is located on the south side of the Yarra in the suburb of St Kilda. This Victorian-era hotel functioned as a kind of epicenter for the decadent culture that produced bands like The Boys Next Door, The Birthday Party, The Moodists, and Young Charlatans. The building's peeling Victorian wallpaper and faded heavy curtains gave the space a sense of faded glory, and there were rumours that the ghost of an old projectionist from the defunct cinema next door roamed the ballroom's derelict upper floors. Scholar Lisa Dethridge describes the site when she writes, "Decades of sea air and wartime depression wore away at the once polished Italianate facade." Sue Davis and Tony Shaw capture the palpable energy of this otherworldly environment in their short experimental film Punkline, made in 1980. In the opening shot, a girl in black tights and a 60s pink satin cocktail dress runs into frame with a can of spray paint. With a cigarette between her red lips, she sprays the film's title in bright red on a white wall. She runs off when we hear the sound of a police siren, and the rest of the film is made up entirely of footage shot inside the Crystal Ballroom on nights when live bands played. Punkline is structured by an alternation between shots of people dancing or watching the bands play, and the repetition of images of people coming up the venue's grand staircase. Its painted Victorian balustrade and richly patterned but tattered wallpaper mark a pathway of ascent into another world where the ferocious darkness of bands like The Boys Next Door was unleashed in rooms with old chandeliers and tessellated Art Deco carpets. A bright light pointed in the same direction as the camera illuminates the punters' faces, giving them an otherworldly appearance. Their bright faces in the dark, visible but inaudible. We watch young people smoking cigarettes, laughing and dancing to music that we can't hear. Instead, there is a score by local band Equal Local. Its sparse bass and percussion is punctuated with sound effects mimicking birds screeching and pigs snorting, while the sporadic repetition of an eerie synth motif brings a haunting, cyclical quality to the images of young people escaping their suburban listlessness. Hearing this instead of their conversations and ecstatic screams produces an uncanny effect, or a sense of simultaneous presence and absence. The footage tells us that these moments happened, but the film holds us at arm's length, refusing to participate in any illusion that we can re-experience these moments. In Donna McRae's 2011 horror film Johnny Ghost, the protagonist is haunted via her own experience of this scene that congregated on the south side of town. McRae's film is about Millicent, a former post-punk who now lives a somewhat solitary life as a hardworking academic. For Millicent, Melbourne's post-punk history is intimately bound up with the loss of her friend and former bandmate Johnny, and this unsuccessfully repressed trauma has begun to surface 30 years on in unpredictable and violent ways. Mostly she is pursued by the ghosts of Johnny, his girlfriend Robin, and their gang of post-punk ghost friends. But in one particular scene, she confronts the eerie destabilization of time and space when, walking down Fitzroy Street, she stops in front of the site of the Crystal Ballroom. As Millicent turns toward the door, the sound of the Fitzroy Street traffic falls away, and she hears the crushing guitars of the birthday party playing inside. So as we've just seen, the return of the past is first signaled by Millicent being able to hear the birthday party playing inside this haunted site. The film then cuts to historical footage of Nick Cave and Rowland S. Howard performing on stage at the Crystal Ballroom. This juxtaposition generates what scholar Tom Gunning, in his essay To Scan a Ghost, describes as a sense of fundamental untimeliness, a return to the past not in the form of memory or history, but in a contradictory experience of presence. The film's use of this footage takes us both into the site and back in time, allowing us to witness the characteristically volatile performance Nick Cave was famous for at this point. If for a moment we believe that this might only be a memory, however, this impression is quickly shattered when we meet Millicent back outside on the street. The sound of traffic puts us in the here and now, but we can also still hear the birthday party playing inside the Crystal Ballroom. Inside, the show is still happening. What Millicent is experiencing in this moment recalls Gunning's assertion that we do not see ghosts, rather, our senses of vision and perception are brought to crisis by them. What provokes Millicent's crisis of vision and perception here, however, is not the appearance of a single ghost, but the spectral presence of an entire cultural scene. This imagining of Melbourne's post-punk scene as a spectral presence is reiterated in Wim Wenders' 1989 film Wings of Desire. By 1983, the birthday party had relocated to Berlin and broken up, sparking the formation of other Australian post-punk bands in a continent halfway across the world. An embryonic incarnation of the Bad Seeds soon emerged, while guitarist Rowland S. Howard became a member of Crime in the City Solution, a band who had reformed in Berlin with a new lineup including Harry Howard, along with Mick Harvey and founding band member Simon Bonney. While Crime in the City Solution did not go on to enjoy the success or longevity of Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds, both bands' performances in Wings of Desire suggest the cultural significance of the Melbourne post-punk scene in West Berlin at this time. Wenders recalls how he began writing Wings of Desire with no idea of the story or characters, but only the motivation to make a cinematic portrait of Berlin. Nevertheless, he says one thing was clear from the beginning. Both the Bad Seeds and Crime in the City Solution had to be in that movie because musically, that's where Berlin was. The post-punks from Melbourne had an inherently cinematic quality that for Wenders seemed to connect to early German expressionist cinema of the Weimar Republic. In Richard Lowenstein's documentary Autoluminescent, Wenders describes the post-punk musicians from Australia as bird-like with a Caligari look. "I don't think anybody ever wore any other colour other than black, and they had this vampirish life. As soon as the daylight came up, they were gone, but when the sun went down, they showed up again." Here, Robert Wine's 1920 film The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari is seen as the antecedent of the Australian post-punk musician's aesthetic, and their nocturnal lifestyle recalls the figure of the vampire popularised by F.W. Murnau's German expressionist horror film Nosferatu from 1922. Wenders captures the figures of the musicians and the Australian post-punk scene more broadly in this moment with absolute adoration.
Three.
Here, his camera swirls around Simon Bonney's writhing figure, which constitutes an archetypical incarnation of the performance style that Nick Cave would also adopt, while Rowland S. Howard moves in and out of view, jerking his guitar. The faces of those in the crowd are illuminated like the ghosts visiting the Crystal Ballroom in Punkline. Only here, the crowds and our own engagement with the Melbourne post-punk scene is more intimate. They stare up at the musicians who, in interview, Fenders refers to as this bunch of Australians who had landed from a different planet in Berlin. Wings of Desire is aesthetically more intimate too. Fenders worked with cinematographer Henry Alleken, who in 1946 had shot Jean Cocteau's hypnotic Beauty and the Beast. For Wings of Desire, Alleken used a silk stocking stretched over the camera lens to generate the film's soft, muted, silent cinema look, which also generates a sense of otherworldliness. Berlin thus becomes an important memory site for the Melbourne post-punk scene via Wings of Desire, where it is imbued with the same sense of otherworldliness found in the other films discussed here. The recent trend towards validating Melbourne's post-punk scene as significant cultural heritage could be a product of nostalgia, a yearning for those fleeting few years when youthful energy powered a collective burst of creativity and experimentation that would go on to influence music and art across the world. But the remediation of the Melbourne post-punk scene, particularly within cinema, has also tended to foreground the ways its cultural memory is marked by a sense of spectral untimeliness. As Darren Tofts suggests, there's a sense in which this cultural history is inherently intangible, and invoking the figure of the ghost gives us a way to acknowledge this. Like the ghost of Anna who wanders the halls of the Berry Street house at the end of Dogs in Space, the Melbourne post-punk scene is like a shimmering apparition, ungraspable yet intermittently visible.